Let me quickly introduce the speakers today. Our keynote speaker is Peter Minang. Peter Minang leads the Alternatives to Slash and Burn program hosted at ICRAF, the World Agroforestry Center. Then we have Carole Saint-Laurent. She is the Senior Forest Policy Advisor, International Union for the Conservation of Nature, and coordinator of the Global Partnership on Forest Landscape Restoration. After that, we will have Valentina Robriglio. She's a scientist working at the International Institute for Tropical Agriculture in Yaoundé, in Cameroon. After that, we have Michael Dutschke. He's the chair of the Global Conservation Standard. And finally, Manuel Sobral Filho. He is the former executive director of ITTO. So I have to make some housekeeping announcements before we start. First, the voting questions, which will be done after the discussion. So after the presentations, there will be some time for discussions. These questions will be appearing on the screen, and I will be reading these questions out to you. And then you will have another 10 seconds to press the button so that we get an immediate response. And I'm also supposed to tell you that there is a internet Wi-Fi in all venues. It's a plug and play, and the password is Durban 2011, everything in lowercase and written together. So I'm going to hand over to Peter Minang. Peter, please, you have the floor.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this event. I'll ask the control to please put up the... Thank you. Thank you very much. I'd like to just present to you some kind of overview of the thinking and some key bullet points around thinking about the place of agroforestry, afforestation, and reforestation in REDD Plus this morning. The presentation with some colleagues in the network. Can you hear me? Okay. Okay, good. Thank you. So I'll just try to do it this way. Thanks. Okay. Hope you can all hear me now. Thank you. So I'll just try to give you some highlights that will set up the discussion for everyone. Not all the points, just trying to go through a number of key points that would help us lead the discussion. The starting point that we take here is that agroforestry, reforestation, and afforestation constitute very relevant strategies for alleviating pressures around forests and significantly contributing to co-benefits, you know, in a landscape approach to REDD Plus. And what you see to your right is the main policy brief that summarizes this set of messages that we're trying to put across today. So you can pick one from out there, or you can get from the website. Yeah. And basically, what we're trying to talk about is the fact that in a natural context, in the dominant reality, in the landscapes that we're talking about, is actually mosaic landscapes that constitute different sorts of mixes of land uses. This is a landscape in Indonesia. Large different pieces of land uses, rice and a bit of banana and rubber, all in almost the same setting, with quite a lot of interactions and in the decision making of the land uses. This is what the Rift Valley looks like in Kenya in most parts. And so this is just an illustration of what the dominant landscapes look like in the different countries. So what do we interpret landscape approaches to be? Basically from two perspectives. One is an analytical frame through which you try to understand the drivers of deforestation, through which you try to look at different scales of interactions, the decision making at individual level, ramming up to community level, and then to subnational level and national levels. The second side of the landscape approach is a perspective that has to do with defining the implementation approach to landscape to REDD Plus, and this has had to do with different kinds of articulation of jurisdictions of REDD Plus at the subnational level. Examples, you have DRC that has said, okay, we do our subnational level by province in the country, the way it's being articulated, but also Vietnam, where they take the view that we do it by district. But on the other hand, we've got a number of REDD pilots and a number of REDD demonstrations that are going by around protected area landscapes or around community managed forest. So that's just to set up the frame around which thinking of what we try to articulate really means. So I will give you four sets of messages during this presentation that fall within the main slide that I showed you. And the first one is that basically agroforestry, afforestation, and reforestation can be part of REDD Plus depending on the definition of a forest. And what do we mean by that? Now, we have this policy brief that we put out that basically lays out the arguments that we make. When does agroforestry, reforestation, and afforestation become REDD or not be part of REDD and only a strategy for achieving REDD Plus? Now, if you look at, I don't want to touch into that because I think you are all familiar with the parameters for the UNFCCC definitions, which go by a range of canopy cover of 10 minimum and 30% maximum, tree diameters, you know, specified between 2 and 5 meters, and also the area of land that is being referred to, of forest, that should be 0.5 hectares to 1 hectare minimum, then that you can classify, and countries have to choose between. There are other parameters that are written into the definition, such as the fact that it is a discretion of the country and the institutional definition of a forest as to whether that area is only carved out as a forest, and supposing that if it is temporarily not forest, it could potentially in situ be converted to forest in the long term. So those are the parameters that you find. And it has a number of inherent contradictions in it. What it means to your left, to your right, sorry, is that natural forest that converts to logging, different cycles of logging, and then eventually fastwood plantations, and then it means it's virtually no deforestation within those definitions, actually. But it could, in a way, be degradation. So that will fall in the second D. The second part of it is that most crop production systems, especially tree crop production systems like coffee, like cocoa, some of them largely will eventually be forest because they represent a lot of these dimensions that you have specified to your left. The third part of the argument is that stable shifting cultivation fallows that are 5 years, 15 years old will fulfill the criteria that you have to your left, and so will technically be seen as forest in those instances. Or if they remain the way they are for 5 years and 15 years, then they will not be considered deforestation in a technical sense. Just to give you an example of the margins of a minimum area of 10% and 30%. If you look at Uganda, this is some analysis that was done by Bob Zoma and a few other people within the institutions that are shown. The implications of if Uganda chose a minimum value of 10%, then only 2.8% of the land area, you know, 2.8% of the land area qualifies, you know, as forest. If they choose 20%, then it goes up to 14.9% because it does include then all the many tree-based systems. And if they choose 30%, it goes up because of the sort of tree-based systems that are involved in the country. So depending on what you choose in your definition, actually what we are now referring to as agroforestry, reforestation, and afforestation, not part of REDD, would eventually be part of REDD. Just to give you another idea, if you look at, this is some analysis done by Bob Zoma as well, and some scientists at ICRAF. It shows you the percentage of forest cover on agricultural land globally. And what you see is that more than a billion hectares of land, agricultural land, actually has a minimum tree cover of 10%. That is actually what is referred to as the minimum that you can choose for the definition of a forest within the UNFCCC. So technically, if you chose 10%, these areas that are officially classified as agricultural land could be considered forest land, actually. Then the second message that we want to talk about this morning, just to lead the discussion, is the fact that agroforestry and tree-based systems can support programs to control deforestation as a sustainable intensification strategy. I think Bob Scholes spoke this morning about the relevance of sustainable intensification. If you look at the definition of intensification that we've spoken about, which I will talk about in a bit, if you look at what has been referred to as the Bullock hypothesis, that if you intensify forest, agriculture, and then people will get, by producing more on the same unit of land, they wouldn't need to clear more forest to meet the demands that we have in the world. And that this graph on to your left shows you that if you need three conditions to be able to do that. If you increase your yield, basically the cultivated area technically should drop. But for it to spare forest, technically you need to have a corresponding reduction in prices. Because if the prices go up, agriculture becomes more profitable, and people go in for more forest land to be able to meet the demand for agricultural products. So, but under different circumstances, intensification, when it's sustainable, will counter this because we expect to have many more benefits. And so just to run through, this is what do you consider intensification? The initial analysis that we've done so far on the Bullock hypothesis has been based on cropping systems intensification, a little bit of livestock intensification, but very little literature is emerging on tree-based systems driven intensification as the emerging part of the emerging concept of sustainable intensification. So this just gives you different perspectives of what we would consider within an intensification frame. These photos actually from some work done by ICRAF in Indonesia. If you look at the photos in Jambi province in Indonesia, where you've had a lot of dynamic land use changes, what you see here is that in the 1990s, it was dominated by logging activities and more extensive rubber plantations. But what you see is an evolution between 2000 and 2005 of more profitable tree crop systems. In terms of forest cover and in terms of carbon, frankly, it doesn't make too much of a difference, and it does meet the minimum requirement of 30%, the maximum requirement for forestry of 30% in terms of what you find there. But all of that is referred to technically as agriculture, but in fact there are strong carbon implications and productivity implications within these systems. What you heard a bit this morning from Bob as well is just to point to the fact that sustainable intensification from a tree crop perspective will be and remains important if you look at the African context compared to the Asian context. This is some report from the World Bank, the World Development Report, I think in 2008, by the World Bank, that shows you that Africa, if you look at Africa, Africa has basically increased production through an area index. So by increasing area of production, basically, that is the only way they have increased yields. But if you look at Asia, on the other hand, the yield increases have been largely, the yield increases have been largely due to yield and rather than by area. So they are intensifying agriculture, producing more in the same units of land or without expanding agriculture in a very strong way. So this is sort of, and this sort of correlates in some cases with the sort of increases in forest areas that you have in Asia. Forest, basically natural forest. What you see is that on this part, if you look at Africa and the wood extraction is increasing, but Africa in the same periods that are being referred to has been experiencing significant deforestation, which means that you have the increasing demand is eating into the increasingly smaller portions of native natural forest that we have. And if something is not done, then this and the demand, the population will continue to increase. 2 billion in the next 50 years, then we will have. But if you average across the world on this block, what you find is that the wood removals in forest is almost 50-50 in terms of timber, industrial wood, and in terms of wood fuel. And that's a very significant thing because the wood fuel is being needs some sources to meet. And I'll show in another example in the rest where people are increasingly going for wood fuel and for timber. Below you find that planted forests only constitute 7% of the forest, of the 4 billion hectares, large, about 2.250 million. That's significant, but these planted forests are growing at 5 million hectares a year, you know, in the period that is being reported here, according to the Forest Resource Assessment 2010. Now, this graph that you find here shows you, the green graph is the legal timber in Cameroon from the forest areas that is considered legal, and the red dots considered the informal sector timber that is from assessed in the markets. And what you find is that there is informal timber is overtaking already the formal timber sector in terms of the domestic market. And all of this timber is coming, most of this timber in the huge urban markets, which is about 75%, is coming from on-farm timber, basically. Although it is still informal and technically illegal. I think Valentina will say a few words about that. But the construction is extremely important. This shows you some of the key species that you have and the distribution of their sources. What you find is that, well, maybe some of the huge hardwood species still come from the forest, but some increasingly perhaps not so important value timber that is consumed in housing, in construction, is still coming from fallows that are part of agriculture by technical definition at the moment, but which could technically become forest. So the fallows and perennial crops and annual crops, if you look at them, the fallows dominate in terms of where the timber is coming from. The last message is that establishing tree systems in themselves, afforestation, reforestation, agroforestry, by the systems themselves is not enough. You do need policy packages that respond to investment needs, that respond to the legal rights challenges that go with it, because in some places, these systems don't develop because the rights to the trees are not very clear, and that's why the Cameroon example is considered to be illegal in a sense, you know, in that sense, and there are investment needs. So we need to, in the landscape approach, we need to find and make sure that we respond to all the environmental services that the systems produce, because REDD in itself, we heard from a number of sessions this week, that the carbon price does not necessarily cover you know, and motivate sufficiently the running and maintenance of these systems. So we need to look at, from a landscape perspective, multiple environmental services. And I must point out that one of the things that we increasingly advocate for is the adaptation side of the equation, associating that to mitigation. One of the main reasons being that these people do this on the ground, there is no difference between mitigation and adaptation. And the challenges are there, yet the funding for adaptation is separate, the funding for mitigation is separate. They are all not sufficient, and we could optimize adaptation and mitigation funding to be able to get the systems there, because they produce the best services that we require as good enough, you know, for us to work with them. Just an example, when you plant a tree in the agroforestry systems, it takes you 3 years or two to get anything out of it. How do you justify that investment in the initial period? What you need to do, maybe you can justify using adaptation funds to pre-fund in the cases where carbon funds cannot sufficient to pre-finance the systems. And just a couple of last words, I think we cannot say that there are no challenges in running these systems in terms of technicalities, in terms of seeds, in terms of, you know, market systems, the market infrastructure that you require. What I showed you in Jambi, what I showed you in the different countries where timber, on-farm timber and afforestation is making headways, because the market infrastructure is relatively more developed compared to Africa. Even in Cameroon, it is because of the proximity to the urban areas that on-farm timber is becoming increasingly significant. I'll rest my case there, and the panelists can follow on with building on this point. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. I'm going to now hand over the microphone to Carole first, and she will have 4 minutes. The other speakers will also have 4 minutes to make a couple of remarks. We are very behind time, as you know. And then we'll have some time for questions and answers. Please, Carole.
Thank you, Henry. It's great to be a part of this event on such an interesting and important topic and with such great co-panelists. We've decided to sit here to save some time and make this as smooth as possible for everyone. If we're squinting at you, it's because there's this bright spotlight right in our faces, not because we're even more confused than we usually are. I will look at things at a sort of broader policy influencing and communications level. How can we persuade the world about these landscape approaches? So first of all, let's address the question right away about what is in the scope of REDD Plus. There's certainly scope in the Cancun decision for agroforestry, afforestation, reforestation, and a whole suite of strategies that involve using trees to transform landscapes. So it's there in writing, it's on paper. What we're not so sure about is whether these kinds of opportunities and approaches are going to get the attention and investment that they really deserve and need. So how can we make the case for landscape approaches, for landscape restoration, landscape management? First of all, I suggest we need to build the evidence of the opportunity. And one thing we've done is that we commissioned an analysis of the global opportunities for landscape restoration. We found that there are 2 billion hectares of lost forests and degraded lands that offer opportunities for landscape restoration. That's an area the size of South America. That doesn't mean that every one of those hectares is ideally suited for restoration. It means that it's worth taking a look at where those opportunities really are by delving down at the national level. To further focus attention on this opportunity, we and our partners, led by the German Environment Minister, Norbert Röttgen, have issued the Bond Challenge, a target to restore 150 million hectares by 2020. Deliberately designed as a contribution to the CBD Target 15 and the REDD Plus goal. Another area that needs attention is achieving a better understanding of the costs and benefits of these landscape approaches and communicating those. For example, IUCN did a very preliminary study of the benefits of restoring 150 million hectares. And discovered that this could generate $85 billion US dollars a year in benefits and values. Yesterday, I learned that in the Niger, 2.5 million people were fed through a restoration initiative involving farmer-assisted natural regeneration. It's a great piece of information. In Shinyanga, Tanzania, household income was doubled above the national average through the application of landscape approaches. There's a multitude of such examples out there. And incidentally, all of these, even though they were not designed in this way, did sequester some carbon. So here you have carbon as a very important co-benefit of these initiatives that took place and were driven by completely different motivations. There's a couple knowledge gaps I suggest that we need to fill. One is, what are the governance and institutional implications of scaling up to the landscape level? It may be that the institutions we have are not ideally suited to dealing with how people are actually implementing landscape level actions on the ground. We need to take a fresh look at those institutions. How can we enhance collaboration? Another aspect, another knowledge gap, or maybe just a challenge of bringing together all the wonderful information that's already out there, is what are the small policy changes that can be made to trigger transformative change across landscapes? So again, to mention Niger, yesterday I heard about how giving farmers ownership of the trees on their land triggered a huge change. In China, in the Miwen watershed, which provides the water for the inhabitants of Beijing, there, the small policy change was the experimental lifting of the logging ban, which allowed people to participate in and implement sustainable forest management. All those examples are out there. How can we pool them in a systematic way so that we can wield more influence in communicating them to the world? And just one final suggestion, which is, can we change the way people look at landscapes? So as they're walking, driving, riding down roadways, and looking around, can we get people to look not at what's missing, what's been lost from the landscape, or not at what's been degraded, but look at those landscapes through a lens of opportunity instead, and start imagining what could be there delivering the benefits that people need. If we can combine that new vision with this evidence, body of evidence that we're building, I think we certainly could promote these landscape approaches in a way that's never been seen before. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carla. I'll just hand over quickly to Valentina so she can make her statement. Please, Valentina.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Henry, and good morning. I'm going to present you a very practical case that I hope will help to understand the importance of landscape approaches. Peter has just presented some recent results of research work conducted by colleagues in CIFOR and Tropenbos that has shown the importance of the domestic sector in tropical timber exporting countries as Ghana and Cameroon. And most of that timber comes from rural land. So what are the challenges? What are the reforms that are needed to avoid that once those resources are finished, people won't move into the forest? What will push farmers to adopt practices to plant trees? We have seen from our analysis that at the national level, in the rural mosaic, trees are diminishing because of logging, of course, even if it is selected, but also because agricultural intensification. In countries like Ghana and in Cameroon, the adoption of full sun-loving cocoa varieties, or the shortening of fallow, or the introduction of new crop that don't like shade, is really leading to a shortage of trees resources, with consequences on the resilience of the agricultural matrix, and consequences also for the capacity that farmers have to adapt to change. We know from studies that started in the 80s from Robert Chambers that trees are very important for farmers to meet households contingencies. So we know on one side they are cutting them, and on the other side they become much more vulnerable. So what we think is that we need to get to integrate at the interface between rural and forest land. We need to integrate agricultural and forestry policies in order to enable farmers to become active actors in the forestry sector. We know that the forestry sector, and in particular the institution in the forestry sector, exclude farmers as timber producers. They have no clear rights on their trees. They have no clear rights on the land they crop. And also, they are not informed about the market. On the other side, they are pushed by measures that won't increase productivity to reduce the timber, to make space for intensive agriculture. So also on that, we need to develop policies for trees-based intensification. There are cases in Ghana of, for example, associated timber and cocoa production system of Taungia system, where timber trees are associated to crops. They are very promising, but they will need to be evaluated in the long term because farmers are adopting it now. But will they keep the trees for 30 years on their land under the pressure that they are experiencing now to increment land productivity? That's my point.
Thank you very much, Valentina. We'll move straight on to Michael Dutschke. Please, Michael, go ahead. It's not working? Take the other one.
Okay.
Oh, wait, I think it's on.
Hello? Okay. Thanks for inviting me, and thank you for the interesting presentation so far. I want to inform you on a new standard that is based on a landscape approach, which is the Global Conservation Standard. It is different in many ways from any other land use related standards that we're looking at, like afforestation, reforestation, like REDD, and also FSC and others, because each of them are only looking at only one modality of land use, while the Global Conservation Standard is looking on a landscape level and is defining its project area by the existence of a conservation area and the existence of what we call commercial buffer zone. So, and the idea is that the existence of the conservation area is being paid by the investor, who's receiving credits that do not offset any emissions in other places, purely voluntary action. And we are at the same time a system that monitors and evaluates carbon, standing carbon in the landscape or other environmental services, and also a system that distributes the benefits to the communities. And one pillar of our system is what we call the stakeholder fund. In every single project situation, independently from its size, where communities, local NGOs, and local governments participate and find the most suitable use for the funds coming in. Why is that attractive to the private sector? It is attractive because it brings multiple benefits to the investor. It is one that CSR values, so corporate social responsibility, definitely. But also, we are looking at any opportunities that arise within our project area, which is part of it, which is conservation, and other parts of which can be used for forestry and different forms of forestry, for agricultural uses, and because these benefits will arise from agricultural or forestry products, from the sale of fruit, and even carbon, we will identify opportunities for carbon within our carbon offsets within our project areas. But we are starting off by selling the CCUs, conservation credit units, only. And with that money, we go start implementing the project and developing it. This sounds very simple, and this is very simple. And it's much easier to understand than any carbon offset methodologies we have been developing so far. As you know, a REDD project may take you two or three years before you can start implementing it. As opposed to that, a GCS project will take you around 3 months before it can be implemented. And that means we are setting up the stakeholder fund. We are also setting up a monitoring system. And while we're implementing the project, we add more elements to it. And we may have a REDD module in it that benefits from the existence of the monitoring system, and that will distribute its benefit to the communities and to the investor. And we are looking at investors that are interested in developing, in rural development of the area. Because what we see, and one of the reasons why forests are on a constant threat is that protected areas, around protected areas, on many occasions, the poorest of the poor live. And they lack lack capital, and they lack capacities to, what you say, identify the potentials of their land. So they make the worst possible use of their land, degrade it, and then move further into the forest. And this is what we want to avoid by raising capacities, by giving them capital to improve the use of their land, and to intensify land use, and thereby add to nutrition and to well-being within the commercial buffer zone, so that they will no longer be opposed against any protection area, but on the contrary, see the benefits and see the value that every single tree brings them while it's standing. And we have been developing the standard over the last 2 years. We're now in the phase of rolling it out. We have two projects that are very close to implementation, and we have a framework contract with the Peruvian National Park Foundation that will, over time and as investment comes in, implement this standard in all the national parks of Peru, helping them to increase the size, what their policy target is, to increase the size of the national parks in Peru from 20 million hectares to 40 million hectares within the next 5 years. And we're looking into, we are discussing with other standards and other NGOs in order to build an umbrella where other certification systems come into play and increase the value of the products and services from our project areas. And that's basically, I will be here over the whole day, and for any details you may be invited to address me.
Thank you very much, Michael. I'm going to hand over to Manuel, please.
Thank you. Perhaps I will initiate my comments just by reminding all of us here that we are still losing a lot of forest, mostly in the tropics. Many of you may be surprised to hear that in boreal and temperate forests, in most of these areas, there is actually an increase in volume of wood. So we need to, of course, focus on the drivers of deforestation And when we have the question posed by the organizers of these events, which Peter elaborated on the role of agroforestry in REDD, I would join him and the other colleagues in the panel stressing that, yes, there is a role, particularly because what we see is that in the natural forests, in the tropics, and in other areas in developing countries, the natural forests are not very competitive with other land use in generating income. You know, for instance, natural tropical forests produce 1 cubic meter per hectare a year, while if you go for plantations, monoculture plantations in the tropics, you can reach 30 or 40 or even 50 in some recent clones of eucalyptus, for instance. So we need to increase the income of the populations that live in and around these forests, natural forests, in order to reduce deforestation, consequently emissions. And one of the ways to do that is in land that is already deforested, or at least in part of that land, intensification with agroforests, for instance. Generating income will, in an intensified way in agroforest or in afforestation, will of course reduce pressure on the remaining natural forests. And not to mention the buffer, physical buffers that can be created too. Now, of course, we have the problem of financing, and then public policies have to be put in place to give financing and on concessional terms, and also with grace, long grace periods. I give you an example in Brazil right now: the plantation programs to restore land that had been cleared and has to be restored by law enjoys lower interest rate and the grace periods of even 15 years. 15 years, which is quite a lot. But again, then we have this dilemma of competition. Do we restore using the forest restoration landscape concept, or we go for monocultures or agroforest? Unfortunately, the market forces are directing landowners to use monocultures or agroforests because there is a greater remuneration. It's not very much the initial cost of restoring the land with the landscape concept or the initial cost of the plantation, but rather the benefits that come later on by harvesting or by getting whatever the restoration effort you give to you. So these are points that we really have to consider. I do not really think that we have a competition between agriculture and REDD. I think what we have is really a competition among many different land use, and we must find ways of remunerating the land use that we want to favor, which is keeping as much as possible natural forest. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Manuel. Okay, I'm going to ask those who have any questions to make their way to the two microphones here in the middle. And while you do that, I will just give a very brief summary of what I heard about this. And then we'll take three questions at a time, and we'll have some answers from the panel at the same time. So please, make your way to the microphones if you have a question. So from Peter, I think we heard four messages. And the first one is about the need to look at landscape approaches in order to address deforestation in an integrated way, because we're looking at leakage. We have we're at the margin of forests, and we cannot only look at forests in isolation. The second point is that agroforestry, afforestation, reforestation can effectively contribute to deflecting deforestation. And then we also heard from Valentina, the on-form timber can produce significant amounts of products that are already coming out of the non-forested areas, and that this can contribute significantly to reducing forest deforestation. And finally, that we need policies beyond the implementation of REDD and other instruments, but these policies have to include value chains and efficiencies and equity. So, and from Carol, I think, you know, she's shown a couple of evidences and the need to provide the vision that we have to look for a more sustainable way of managing all the landscapes and not only the forests. As well, from Valentina, the need to improve our institutions that can provide the background in which these policies and measures can take place. And Michael showed us this global conservation standard of his, and I'm sure there will be more interest in that. And I think Manuel's final words about the need to increase the income of forest dwelling and people living at the margins of the forest in and doing that in an environmentally sustainable and biodiverse way, I think this is very, very pertinent. So we have a couple of questions at the microphones right now. We'll start at the beginning. Please introduce yourself quickly and your institution, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm James Mayers. I'm from IIED. Thank you very much for a great keynote and a really good comments from the panel. And this question, I think, picks up one of the points you were just making, Henry. It seems to me that there's great developments in this thinking quite coherently about landscape approaches. And there are clearly huge opportunities, particularly on the restoration side. And as Carol said, some of those opportunities are sometimes triggered by relatively small changes in decision making. But when we think of the big, bad deforestation context, the changes required are perhaps on a hugely greater scale. We need pretty much wholesale reforms of governance systems. What do landscape approaches really tell us there? Because there's a danger that they become great analytical tools, but could even get in the way of the, you know, the hard-boiled business of renegotiating power to address some of the drivers of deforestation. I'd be very keen to hear any comments about those sort of contexts and with these approaches. Thanks.
Excellent. Thank you very much. We'll take two more questions. Please, sir, in the back.
Thank you very much, Chair, and I'll address myself to Carol and...
Introduce yourself, please.
Sorry, I beg your pardon. The name is Michael Peter. I'm from Forestry South Africa. We represent the commercial timber industry, plantation industry in South Africa. I just wanted to thank Carol for clearing up what I think has been a real debate about whether afforestation and reforestation does in fact feature as part of REDD Plus or whether it's provided for elsewhere, and I know the literature has been very confusing about that, so thank you very much for saying it emphatically. I think it is important, but I think also what we heard earlier on at the launch of Forest Day 5 from all the speakers was that what comes out of these working groups helps to shape the negotiations at the COP, and I would move for an adoption by this working group of firstly the recognition that afforestation and reforestation obviously does form part of REDD Plus, but that secondly there should be greater recognition for it in terms of the UNFCCC processes, because at the moment it's not adequately provided for. There is a scope for plantations in terms of CDM projects, but they're limited to 1%. And there's only one country in the world, and that's New Zealand, that has such an emissions trading scheme. So we're delighted that it forms part of REDD Plus, notwithstanding the fact there isn't a funding mechanism as of yet for it now beyond the voluntary carbon market. And I would argue that we should move as this group to get greater recognition for it through the KP and the LAC mechanisms. Thank you.
Excellent question. Thank you. Please, sir, at the beginning, at the front.
Thank you. My name is Albert Ackhurst. I represent the Green Ticket. I want to respond and ask a question, and then it's with regard to question 1 and 4, and that is, why do we never speak about alien invasive species, especially when it gets to reforestation, reforestation, agroforestry? Because the very definition for forests for the subcontinent in Africa says that all our alien invasive stands extant are considered forest. The irony is that is the very death of our landscape in terms of reduced water, reduced nutrition in the soils, erosion and floods. We are using these in reforestation projects in Africa and especially in Kenya. With respect to Kenya, the photograph I illustrated was of alien invasive stands. It was eucalyptus and wattle, which burn easily and which also denudes the swells and causes fires, floods, erosion. Can't the definition consider alien invasive species in subcontinent countries? That's a question. Thanks.
Thank you. I think I'll hand the word over to the panel now. Maybe Peter would like to address the first question, and Carol was specifically addressed in the second question. Valentina, maybe you can answer. Maybe somebody else can answer that question. Okay, Peter, please.
Thank you very much. And very pertinent comments, I think. Sorry I can't see some of you, but with respect to the first question regarding landscape approaches being a more analytical tool rather than a more implementation-driven tool, I think that in many cases you're right, because we have not challenged ourselves enough to answer some of the pertinent questions that we have at the moment. One of the big questions, as I said, in the second part of the landscape approaches that I presented, I said it can be a useful analytical tool, but the other part of it is that could it not become a more important implementation tool? I'll give an example. What is the basis for setting a province as an implementation, as a sub-national level implementation scheme for a country, when in fact the drivers of deforestation that should be the entry point are in fact beyond provincial levels? Yeah? So the whole question would be, how do you link the analytical results to find the appropriate sub-national level where implementation would make sense? How do you cascade a number of layers of complications in the drivers of deforestation analysis to be able to determine where is the appropriate level of implementation in terms of a landscape, be it political, be it agroecological, or be it a catchment area of a deforestation, of drivers of deforestation. So I think that we have challenges, but we have to be able to do that. If we don't do that and see landscape approaches as an implementation tool, then we will eventually fail. Third part, I think I will go to the third question, because the second question, I think I fully agree with the speaker. The third question about invasive alien species, I did mention in my last slide the fact that one of the technical challenges are, you know, looking at invasive species. And I recognize that it's an important issue to address, but part of the problem, if you refer to eucalyptus in Kenya, for example, scientifically, the number of, you know, species, varieties that we have of eucalyptus, some technically, scientifically argue that they are not that environmentally unfriendly. Some are more environmentally unfriendly. So you need to find what is the right species to be able to do that. It's not yet scientifically conclusive that eucalyptus are environmentally harmful. I think that is an important point to note. But if you look at the FRA 2010, it actually addressed that question a bit, and it said that almost 90% of the reforestation and afforestation are not necessarily linked to alien species, actually. So there is a 10% problem that we need to address, but we can't blacklist the whole activity because we have a challenge that we have to fight. So I recognize it, but we need to recognize that it's a problem and we have to deal with it. Thank you.
Excellent. Carol, do you want to take a few minutes to answer the second question?
Okay. I might add a point or two about the first question as well. I think if you look at landscape approaches combined with REDD Plus, they can act as a trigger for having a national conversation about land use. no matter what else will come out of, of REDD Plus, and but I think in particular linking it with the landscape approaches allows you to start looking at what people need and want from their landscapes and scaling up that conversation to the national level. And also can be a trigger for looking at your governance arrangements, because really working at a landscape level is all about negotiating among stakeholders what they need from those landscapes. And so that too can result in a national level policy change. With respect to Peter's question, or Michael's question, the second question about afforestation and reforestation and REDD Plus, you know, it's not spelled out in there, obviously, that would fall under enhancement of forest carbon stocks, or that's what we would expect. I think it's pretty clear that plantations were in the mind of the negotiators in some way, because they made a point of adopting a safeguard which explicitly states that that REDD Plus action should not lead to the conversion of natural forest ecosystems into plantations. So, you know, it's there, it's not spelled out. We don't have specific definitions of each of the elements of REDD Plus. I think they will all become clear as countries go, just move ahead and begin implementing REDD Plus actions.
Excellent. Does anybody else want to make a comment to any of the questions that were raised so far? No? Okay, so the gentleman in the back, please. You had a question, and then...
Chair, thank you very much for this excellent presentation. I think it's so relevant talking about agroforestry, afforestation, and reforestation. My name is Bremley. I come from the state of Meghalaya in northeast India, and I work with global plantations, and we're doing organic agroforestry projects in Asia, Sri Lanka, India, and Malaysia. Through experience, I think it's very important to understand that most people in these developing countries don't have resources to actually develop and validate these projects. It's nice to hear that it's a new standard that only takes 3 months before you can start a project. But there are other standards out there that take much longer and cost a lot more. My question is, how do you actually validate and make these costs, especially for community-led reforestation projects, more cheap, more economically viable for them? And also, how do you address the rights for the carbon, who owns the land, and how they trickle in to the actual people that build those forests, that maintain the land in the long term? Because I know these projects have a 10 years cycle before they have to reevaluate the baseline for another 10 years regarding REDD. And I think it's different for AR projects where you go up to 30 years or 50 years with the buffer. Because I know of a very interesting project that Community Forestry International is developing in Meghalaya, working directly with the local chiefs in 63 villages. But obviously, they're doing it in a voluntary manner, and it takes a long time to raise money and make it sustainable. I'm wondering if there are any stories from other countries where you have a best practice to show that communities by themselves developing these projects and keeping the costs for overheads down, and when the money comes back, it actually trickles down to the people at the grassroots to benefit them in the long term. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Rami. Sir, please.
Hafiz Jamil, Noir, an NGO working in public afforestation efforts in Sudan. I have been expecting, or I would, that if this session would have addressed the issue of sand dune fixation, because we are, our farms in Sudan are endangered by the encroachment of forest, because you know Sudan is just lying on the southern edge of the Great Sahara, African Sahara. So farming there needs to be protected from sand dune encroachment. And sand dune encroachment always causes problems to the farmers there. So I have been just expecting this issue to be or should have been addressed by people here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Does anybody else have a question in the meantime? I will ask first Michael, probably because you were addressed particularly, and then anybody else to answer the question of this gentleman here. Michael, please.
Yes, let me try to answer your question. Yes, the Global Conservation Standard is a fully fledged standard, and it is monitored, reported, and verified, and it is verified annually. So what we are doing is we are basing on our experience in the carbon market and using the same monitoring technologies and even improving those for the communities. But the most important thing perhaps is exactly what you say, getting the communities in the driver's seat. We give them money for trees standing there. And we're looking at starting with projects that with kind of low-hanging fruit. There are so many national parks in the world that are mostly on paper. So this is where we're starting. And we install the institution of our stakeholder fund there, because they will ultimately be the ones to decide where this money coming in will be used, and whether it's going to be used for afforestation or for agroforestry or whatsoever, which best opportunities they see. And we also try to educate them on the potential they have on their area, because much of that isn't known by the communities or even the NGOs themselves. The big benefit is that we're paying upfront. So our investors pay for the first year of the carbon standing there, and we're talking about standing carbon, about carbon stocks, not about carbon flows, like in the traditional carbon market sense. We pay for what we see. We don't need a baseline for that. We pay every year the carbon, say the forest is still there, we pay. We have a methodology that based on IPCC values, vaguely quantifies the carbon stocks for the first year, and after that we will have monitoring results. And so we can really, once if we find an appropriate investor, we can go ahead immediately, and while we are going, we can use part of this money to develop carbon offset projects, depending on the baseline we can assess there. There may be, for instance, part of the conservation area may be actually under threat, not necessarily all of it. So we would develop a REDD project for this particular part. Or we could have activities, forestry activities like sustainable forest management in our buffer zone, or afforestation practices that would qualify under the criterion of additionality. And then we would use part of the money for the development of these projects. But as we are monitoring from the first minute onwards, we will have the data available to sustain a backward crediting for as soon as the carbon offset project has been validated and approved. So this is the big benefit in as opposed to starting project development, methodology development, project development, waiting for verification, for validation. And only after so long time you can start implementing your project. This is what we're trying. But I also see that there's a huge fixation of the market on carbon. And I wouldn't bet too much on carbon, because as you see, we don't have much prospects on what the carbon market will be and for how long it will be there. And we're talking about long periods. Our projects last a minimum of 30 years. And we don't know what the carbon market will be in 30 years, but we do know that in 30 years from now, we will have nearly 9 million, or the population of 9 billion inhabitants, we will have a huge increase of demand for food and for biofuels, and thereby we, when using areas now in a more intensive land use, we can produce food and cash crops for the communities, and also the investors who will benefit from the existence of these projects, because they get multiple benefits. They get their CCUs first, which are purely an image factor. It sells the good idea, but then they may get carbon, they may get revenues from the production of goods and services in the area. And this is what a forward-looking investor should look for. It's not only carbon, and you can't eat carbon, and communities don't know what carbon is. Try and explain a local community what the baseline is. I bet you will fail, but they know what a tree is, and they know what if you tell them you leave this tree standing, I give you $1 per year. That's something they can calculate upon.
Thank you very much, Michael. That's excellent illustrations of the question. Would somebody want to answer the question about the encroachment of sand dunes in the Sudan?
I'm really, really sorry that we didn't address that part of the equation. But I mean, we see sort of there is this great green wall program within the AU and in Africa, something that is trying to look at that sort of thing. I don't know if we can call it a landscape approach, but that would be something that can sort of start addressing what you're talking about. But sorry, we couldn't see that need. But I'm sure we can try to think about it. Thanks.
Thank you, Peter. Does anybody have another question? We do have some more time. Please, madam, make your way to the microphone. We still have time for one or two more questions. So please, if you have a question, make your way to the microphones. Please introduce yourself.
Thanks so much. My name is Francesca De Gasperis. I'm the Europe Director of the Green Belt Movement. And thanks so much. It was a very interesting interventions by each of you. I was particularly interested in the global conservation project. And I think what I wanted to talk about was that we know that intact ecosystems are required to create buffers to prevent desertification. We know that invasive species are reducing the ability for intact ecosystems to function correctly. So I think while I respect what Peter was saying about we're not knowing all the signs yet, for communities, we really need to give them guides that they can work with so we're not held back by science, so we can really move forward. And the Green Belt Movement produced a report for COP, which talks about our experiences, excuse me, with CDM and other climate finance projects. And I urge you to read the report. It talks about the challenges that we have. It talks about the fact that upfront funding isn't there. A lot of the things we know. But really, these projects cannot be delivered in the way they are currently structured. And we do need to take this very seriously if we want to be effective on the ground. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much. Since there's no other question, does Peter or and Michael, also you were asked to answer.
Yeah, thank you. I can only support you in that. I've been working on carbon and land use for 15 years now. And I think the basic problem is that you're only looking at one land use modality, irrespective of the situation it is in. And we know that each situation, each forest is an individual, and it is determined and structured by its socioeconomic insertion. And therefore, I would I see opportunities for afforestation projects within project areas and within landscapes. That makes sense, but you have to look at how they are working, how they're functioning, who is living there, what they can live on, and who is leading the process. And this is where I see the need for a kind of a meta standard, for an umbrella under which these activities can be carried forth.
I think, I do respect that perspective. One thing that I think we need to keep in mind, I think, is as Michael mentioned, there are opportunities out there. I mean, right now we are not talking about NAMAs at all. I agree that they are not fully developed. We don't fully know what they are, but we need to be forward-looking. That provides us an opportunity to define how we want to look at not only one mechanism, which is the CDM, not only one mechanism, which is REDD plus, but looking at a basket of opportunities within the NAMAs. If you take Indonesia, for example, I think those of you who follow how REDD is evolving in the countries, if you look at the countries that are going beyond, that are far, further on in the process in REDD, they are now discovering, after thinking about the RPP processes, that if you disconnect this, what you call forest, from the rest of the landscape, you basically will not answer the questions. So we need to be forward-looking to look at what opportunities do NAMAs give us to bring these things together. And that is where I think landscape approaches will become most useful in the next 5 years, for example. I think that gives us an opportunity also to mobilize investments beyond REDD, you know, and combine a lot of investment streams across sectors to be able to invest in landscape approaches. So I still remain really relatively more optimistic as far as, because I think people would eventually get there at some point, and we would have to try to understand it. Otherwise, we may not reduce any emissions at all. I'm sorry, but. Thanks.
Thank you, Peter. Okay, so there seems to be one more question here, and we'll take that, because we are requested to stop earlier due to the late start, and I'll try to do this by 12:45, and we also still have to do this voting thing, which is new for me, so let's see how that works out. So please, madam, introduce yourself.
Hello, everybody. I'm Natalia Reatei. I come from Peru, and I studied at TU Dresden in Germany. So my question goes to Mr. Dutschke, and I want to know how this global conservation standard is going to cope with some conflicts that they are in the buffer zones in some national parks in Peru, especially with mining activities.
Nice and short question. Thank you. Please.
Yeah, we actually have
short answer too.
Okay, we have a number of Peruvian projects in the pipeline that have been submitted to our technical panel. I can't give you details on those in this moment, but what I know is that mining is a semi-legal activity in Peru, and as this is always the question how you do it, and this semi-legal status with no capital or very low capital, it is doing the biggest possible damage. So if you increase if you capitalize the sector, and if you get in companies that know how to deal with the environment, and that, for instance, do gold digging and gold processing without mercury, you can improve the land use even for mining operations, and these companies are very interested in having a secure water source and to be seen as environmental responsible. So these can actually, and we're talking to one company in particular, these will actually be a domestic source for the sale of this type of conservation credits.
Okay, thank you very much. This gentleman is standing there. This is the last question I will take. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Faisal Parash from Global Environment Center in Malaysia. I'd just like to raise a couple of experiences from Southeast Asia relevant to this. Firstly, in Sabah, there is between two national parks, Kinabalu and Croker Range National Park, there's a large area of community lands with about 70% tree cover, but only a relatively small portion, one could say, is still as forest, natural forest. The rest are community rotational cultivation lands, but still with significant tree cover. And I think that it is important to provide some mechanism to engage such in maintaining the relative tree cover on their areas. But I think the constraint in that area is a relatively small area would be classified as traditionally as intact forest. And therefore, from a normal REDD approach, you would only be looking at maintaining that forest and not looking at all of the on the community lands. A second issue is in some sort of peatland areas. When you remove forest cover from the peatland area, you're actually leaving 95% of the carbon store, which is in the below ground. But because the forest cover is gone, normally you will say this is non-forest area, so that would not necessarily fit into the REDD mechanism. So I think it's imperative to have this broader landscape approach that these very high carbon can still be incorporated somehow into the process. So the question for the panel is, do they, if they're aware of the process,
please repeat the question.
Yeah. What mechanisms may there be, or any move towards what was discussed about a year or two ago of REDD plus plus, where you would have this broader landscape approach, and that you would be able to really look at the carbon stock on the adjacent agriculture or community lands. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Does anybody want to answer the question? Manuel?
This is indeed a very important question. And has to be addressed because, as he mentioned, the peat forests in Southeast Asia contain a substantial amount of carbon below the ground. Of course, since REDD is still under the discussion, there is a room for consideration of these aspects. I would like to take the opportunity to mention also that we should not lose sight to the fact that the carbon balance is not all. We have to give way to some other aspects that are significant when we reduce deforestation. For instance, conservation of biodiversity. When we talk about the natural forest and when we talk about the restoring forest with the landscape concept, we favor biodiverse conservation. And of course, you know, that there, if we only talk about making payments for the on the base of the net carbon that that we avoid emission, it does not take the whole picture. I don't know how that would have to be or could be considered a REDD mechanism, but that's something that we should not lose sight of. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Manuel. So, I would like to thank everybody for their questions and comments, and also the panel very much for their answers and their comments, and particularly for Peter, his excellent keynote speech. Now, before everybody runs out for lunch, please take these devices that are lying on your chairs, and I'm going to ask the technical staff to bring up the questions on this screen here in the back, and I will read them out. That will ensure that I'm not taking too little time, and then you will have another 10 seconds to answer the question. So breakdown of the audience. This is easy. Choose the option that best characterizes the organization that you represent at Forest Day 5. Private sector, NGO, government, international organization, academic, or other. Excellent. So we have 10% private sector, mostly NGOs, lots of international organizations, and 20% academics, and just 7% government. What a pity. Thank you. Next question. To what extent do REDD Plus negotiators recognize the importance of landscape approaches in REDD Plus? Not at all, somewhat, very well. Please. Okay, a majority goes for the middle option. Thank you very much, 65%. Next question. To what extent do REDD Plus negotiators recognize the importance... No, that we had that one. To what extent do REDD Plus negotiators recognize the importance of landscape approaches in REDD Plus as strategies for addressing drivers of deforestation and forest degradation? As an integral part of the REDD Plus mechanism, both A and B above, such activities should be included in a separate mechanism. Please make your vote now. Okay, so this is fairly well distributed. Okay, sorry, the question has may not have been done as, you know, as clearly as it would have, should have been. Okay, thank you very much. Next question. Should REDD Plus funds be invested in agroforestry, afforestation, and reforestation as part of strategies for achieving REDD Plus? Not at all, a little, or substantially? Please. Overwhelming. Thank you. Okay, I don't have to comment that. Next question. Which of the following has been the greatest challenge for the inclusion of agroforestry and climate change mitigation strategies so far? The lack of finance, the exclusion of agriculture from the CDM and REDD Plus, the lack of technical capacity by program implementers, UNFCCC negotiations and procedures, rights and ownership issues like land, trees, and carbon tenure. Please vote now. Okay, so most people think the second question, exclusion from agriculture from CDM and REDD, is the main reason. And then we have three times around close to 20% lack of finance, negotiations, and rights and ownership. Oh, that's very diverse. Thank you. Lack of technical capacity seems to be the issue that is least doubted for the reason. Okay, I think this next one is the final question. It's a long question. Which of the following is likely to be the most useful contribution to REDD Plus landscape approaches? Intensification of production through agroforestry as a strategy to reduce deforestation, increased timber production on farms or in woodlots as a strategy to reduce forest degradation, increased fuel wood production on farm in woodlots as a strategy for reducing forest degradation, and landscape approaches as a means to enhancing synergies between mitigation and adaptation, for example, in ecosystems, biodiversity, and livelihoods benefits. Please vote now. I hope you've understood the question. All right. Number four, overwhelming, 65%, two-thirds, for landscape approaches as a means to enhancing synergies between mitigation and adaptation. That's a very good result, I think. And second, 20% intensification of production through agroforestry. That's also very good. Thank you very much for this effort and your time and listening. Before you all leave, I would like to ask my boss, Tony Simons, who has made his way here, to just make a few final remarks. He doesn't know about this, so caught him off guard, maybe. He's finally found his way from the press conference that introduced the new challenge CRP, the CGIAR research program on forest trees and agroforestry. Maybe he wants to say a few words about that. Tony.
Thanks very much, Henry, and sorry to keep you from your lunch. Yes, very briefly, the Vice President of the World Bank, Rachel Kite, the Director General of CIFOR, Francis Seymour, and myself launched the CRP6. This is the CGIAR research program on forest trees and agroforestry. It is an ambitious 10-year program. There's a press release in the main hall about it now. It involves 22 institutions, work on five substantive areas, smallholder production systems, the forest and tree resources that support forestry and agroforestry, on environmental services, on climate change mitigation and adaptation, and lastly, on trade issues. It was very exciting to see the support of the Vice President to this initiative. We recognize the first funding program of $230 million over 3 years is actually only a fraction of what is needed. However, that is the amount that we hope to leverage others to join the partnership to come together. Refreshingly and excitingly still is the fact that this issue you've been debating here this afternoon on landscape approaches to addressing these issues is firmly embedded in that and endorsed in it. So I won't take up any more of your time, and thank you for your engagement in this particular session.